Is it possible for someone to do penance as satisfaction for their sin? There are four main parts to the sacrament of confession: contrition, confession, penance or satisfaction, and then absolution. The first three parts are done by the penitent person, and then the fourth part, absolution, is done by the priest. Here we're going to be talking about that third part, penance or satisfaction, and this third part can be referred to by either of those terms. The first big thing that we need to do here is to unravel what exactly is meant by the word satisfaction. When my Protestant ears hear the word satisfaction, I think about Jesus paying my debt on the cross, all of it, and me being justified. Let me read you an example of how Protestants speak about satisfaction. Christ, by his obedience and death, did fully discharge the debt of all those that are thus justified, and did make a proper, real, and full satisfaction to his Father's justice in their behalf. But when Catholics refer to satisfaction in this context, they're referring to something that's a bit different. Forgiveness of sin is one thing, but even after forgiveness happens, there are still temporal effects of sin that need to be paid for. So satisfaction here is referring to the temporal consequences. If you watch the videos on purgatory that I did with Dr. Walatka, he gave an example of this. He said that if his son disobeyed him and threw the ball in the house and broke a window, he would forgive his son, but there would still be a broken window that needed to be fixed. So using that example, a Protestant would say, Christ paid my debt for that broken window on the cross. When I received forgiveness, my debt for that broken window was canceled. It's already been paid by Christ. Now, out of love and gratitude, I should want to try to repair that window as best I can to make things right for the people that I've harmed. But strictly speaking, there is no longer a debt that needs to be repaid. A Catholic, on the other hand, would say what Dr. Walatka said. Even after forgiveness happens, there are still temporal consequences of sin that must be satisfied. Okay, now with that understanding, let's look at the official teaching on satisfaction or penance and see how it fits within the sacrament of confession. As we go along, I'm going to point out how satisfaction relates to the temporal consequences, and then after that, I'm going to address six big problems that I see. Let's start with the Council of Trent. If anyone says, concerning temporal punishment, that no satisfaction is made to God through the merits of Christ, by means of the punishment inflicted by him and patiently borne, let him be anathema. So this is saying that satisfaction is made through these temporal punishments. Now let's look at the Catechism of the Catholic Church. Absolution takes away sin, but it does not remedy all the disorders sin has caused. Raised up from sin, the sinner must still recover his full spiritual health by doing something more to make amends for the sin. He must make satisfaction for or expiate his sins. This satisfaction is also called penance. Then it says this: the penance the confessor imposes must correspond as far as possible with the gravity and nature of the sins committed. It can consist of prayer, an offering, works of mercy, service of neighbor, voluntary self-denial, sacrifices, and above all, the patient acceptance of the cross we must bear. Such penances help configure us to Christ, who alone expiated our sins once for all. That part is interesting to me. They allow us to become co-heirs with the risen Christ, provided we suffer with him. The satisfaction that we make for our sins, however, is not so much ours as though it were not done through Jesus Christ. We who can do nothing ourselves, as if just by ourselves, can do all things with the cooperation of him who strengthens us. Thus, man has nothing of which to boast, but all our boasting is in Christ, in whom we make satisfaction by bringing forth fruits that benefit repentance. These fruits have their efficacy from him. By him they are offered to the Father, and through him they are accepted by the Father. Okay, so now for the six problems that I see. And there may be more. These are just the things that popped out to me as I was working on this. Number one relates to the small part of that that wasn't talking about temporal punishments. Most of it was about temporal punishments, but not all of it. At the beginning, it talked about how absolution takes away sin. So going back to that Catholic distinction that we talked about earlier, forgiveness is one thing, temporal punishment is another thing. So this is saying that forgiveness comes through absolution, and then penance relates to the temporal punishment. But forgiveness doesn't come through absolution. The Bible is clear that forgiveness comes through faith. To him, all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Number two, the Protestant side of that distinction that we made earlier regarding satisfaction, the Protestant side of that distinction is correct. Now, I know it won't be a surprise to you to hear a Protestant say that, but I say it because it's supported by Scripture. True satisfaction by Christ on the cross and true forgiveness for me means that there is no more debt to pay, either eternal or temporal. As I talked about in a video with Pastor Brian Episcopo regarding punishment of sin, there still can be discipline for children of God out of love for that child, but there is no more debt to pay. Colossians 2 says this, "When you were dead in your transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all our transgressions, having canceled out the certificate of debt consisting of decrees against us, which was hostile to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross." Romans 4 says this, "And David speaks likewise of the blessedness of the man to whom God credits righteousness apart from works. Blessed are they whose lawless acts are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will never count against him." And Hebrews 10 says this, "Their sins and lawless acts I will remember no more. And where these have been forgiven, an offering for sin is no longer needed." If you have been forgiven, there is no more temporal debt to pay. Number three, this doesn't take into account the infinite nature of sin. I mentioned in a different video regarding who we really sin against, that all of our sins, even our supposedly small sins, are against an infinitely holy God. And that means that all of our sins are infinite sins. And infinite sins deserve infinite punishment. So even if temporal punishment was separate from eternal forgiveness, and it's not, but even if it was, a little bit of temporal punishment is not going to satisfy that debt. It is an infinite debt. Number four, a just God would not require more than full payment of a debt. I went into this in the video regarding the justice of God. God is an absolutely just God, and a just God requires full payment of a debt. And that's what Jesus did on the cross. For God to then require additional payment on that same debt in terms of temporal punishment for us would be injustice. Number five, there's a problem with the way this teaching blends what we do and what God does in terms of cooperation. I've gone into this topic before in a video regarding merit And then another video with Pastor Philip Duncanson regarding Soli Deo Gloria. Reformed Protestants do talk about God doing things through us, but not in a way where we contribute anything of merit. As we read, the Council of Trent does talk about satisfaction being made to God through the merits of Christ. And the Catechism says, Christ alone expiated our sins once for all. And then the whole last part of that paragraph 1460 that we read talks a lot about God working through us. I see those statements, I really do. But the Catechism also says that the sinner must make satisfaction for or expiate his sins. And we who can do nothing ourselves, as if just by ourselves, can do all things with the cooperation of him who strengthens us. And once you layer on top of this what the Catechism says about merit, it's clear that in these works, merit is at least partially attributable to the person. It's not a purely sovereign God achieving his ends through his people. This is always going to be a problem where the Catholic idea of cooperation comes up. And number 6, how despicable is sin? I mentioned earlier that it was infinite, but even aside from that, how serious and wicked is sin? The Catechism says this: the penance the confessor imposes must correspond as far as possible with the gravity and nature of the sins committed. It can consist of prayer and offering, works of mercy, service of neighbor, voluntary self-denial, sacrifices, and above all, the patient acceptance of the cross we must bear. So you're telling me that if I commit a mortal sin, that sin is so serious that it severs my relationship with God, and I will go to hell if I die in that state. So I go to confession, and I confess that sin, and the penance for that sin, the penance that's supposed to correspond to the gravity of that sin, is give an offering? Service of neighbor? What? The satisfaction that corresponds to the gravity of a sin that will send me to hell is voluntary self-denial. This doesn't even pretend to take sin seriously.